The name of the Lord, welcome those who are on live stream also. We're continuing in the Gospel of John. This will be our 11th exposition. We'll be in chapter 1, verses 25 through 28. You'll remember that there's a group of Pharisees that were sent out by the Pharisees in general to find out the identity of John. And the one who asked who he was, wanted to know who he was. Who he was that was mentioned in the Bible. That's what they were asking. He wanted to know what God had said to Moses and the prophets that would identify who John was. That's what they were asking. And they weren't particularly satisfied, appears up to this point, with what he said. He first of all told them who he wasn't, that he wasn't Christ, he wasn't Elijah, and he wasn't that prophet that was foretold by Moses. Then he told them who he was. He was the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the paths of the Lord, that was told by Isaiah the prophet. Now from the text, it appears they didn't even think about what he said. They just kind of glossed over it completely. He identified a particular person, a voice. It was a particular, it wasn't just a general voice, it was a particular person who was speaking. He identified himself as that. And what he was going to do, every valley shall be exalted, Isaiah said, every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. That was Isaiah 40. 4 through 5. That was what was going to happen when this voice. It was an epoch of change. Absolute change was going to commence with this voice speaking. God is going to intrude himself, impose himself, if you please, into society, and things are going to be straightened out that had not been straightened out before. And pits and valleys are going to be raised, and mountains are going to be lowered, and a way cleared for a path for people to come to Christ, come to God. See, that was what he was going to do. Now, it appears plain that their religion, which is the outworking of what's inside, had managed to hide these things from them. Because God had upon this nation, he had poured out the spirit of deep sleep on this nation. So they couldn't understand the Bible. Someone say, here, read this. They say, I can't understand it. I don't know what it's saying. Can't understand. That's what they were saying in their hearts here. They didn't know what John was talking about. When he said who he was, a voice crying in the wilderness. So they continued to ask him some more questions, and we're going to have one of them here tonight. See, they can't learn because God's put them to sleep. You really gotta see this. There's some people that you're wasting your time testifying to them. You just do it initially, and you find out they're stone dead. They're asleep. God's put them to sleep because they're not as sincere as they let on. God doesn't put sincere people to sleep.
Amen.
So if they've got the spirit of deep sleep, that tells you a whole lot about them. So this matter continues to this day. People that don't understand what you're doing when you're serving the Lord. They just don't understand it. They don't know who you are. When you deliver the word of God, or you expound the gospel of Christ, or you expound Christ, they do not know what you're talking about. Just like these people here. And it's because there's a spirit of deep sleep that's been poured out upon the professing church just as it was upon Israel. Because the professing church did exactly what Israel did. They went about their own way and ignored what God had said. The same thing has happened. So then we take up with verse 25. He's told them, he's a voice. They say unto, were sent to the Pharisees. They asked him and said, why baptizest thou then? If thou be not Christ, that Christ, nor Elias, neither that prophet. John answered them, saying, I baptize with water. But there standeth one among you whom ye know not. He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoe latches I am not worthy to unloose. These things were done in Bethabara, beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. If thou, now you notice how these people reasoned. They had some understanding of Scripture, but not much. So if you're not Christ, Elijah, or the prophet, and they couldn't think beyond that, see. These men thought their questions were so sufficient that John had answered unsatisfactorily. They didn't think he was answered, make attempt to answer him. So they wouldn't be able to offer enough evidence to the Pharisees. See, they have to go back and say, we still don't know who he is. That was not what they wanted to do. The reason that John was thinking with, the reason they couldn't is to understand what he said is John was thinking with God in mind. And they were thinking with their traditions in mind. And there is a big difference between those two things. That's why people can't understand. If you talk to someone and you sense they just can't understand what you're talking about, they have a different point of reasoning than you do. Their reason in light of what they already are convinced is right. Your reasoning from the standpoint of God's word and your fellowship with Christ and knowledge of the truth. So you're reasoning from a different vantage point than their reason. You can't cave in to those kind of people. You can't make it more simple so they'll understand it. The problem isn't that what you said is too complicated. That's not the problem. So you can try and doctor up what you're saying, reduce it down, explain it, and elaborate on it. See, but that's not what the problem is. The problem is you're thinking from a different point of view than they're thinking. So we have sectarian postures. People reason within the framework of their sectarian posture. So there are some people, they think like Catholics. That's how they think. Other people, they think like Baptists, or Presbyterians, or Restorationists, or Lutherans, or Quakers, or Mennonites, or ad infinitum. Their circumference of thought is too limited. Why do you think people argue with you about things that are plain to you? You think, why could anyone not see this? It's because they're thinking as one of these groups. They're thinking as a sectarian. They're not thinking as a believer. They're not thinking as what we might say a Bible believer. That isn't even how they're thinking. They have a different point of reference. Now, this is all done in spite of the fact and God has been very upfront about this. The requirement is all speak the same thing. Amen. Now see, they just, sectarianism just pushes that to the side. Says, we're not going to do that. The deliberate act of their, quote, free will. They decide they're not going to do it. Even that's plain enough, isn't it? All speak the same thing and have the same judgment. Think the same way. But that's just, it's like that wasn't in the Bible at all. And anybody say, well, everyone has a right to their own opinion. No, they don't. No, they don't. Person has to come to that realization.
Don't many of these folk think that they're already doing that and that you're the one who's out of line?
Yeah, but they're thinking institutionally, but they don't know they are.
Yeah, that's right.
They don't know they are. See, you've thought differently than they, and they think there isn't any other way to think.
Yeah.
Why do they think that? Because that's the way they've been taught. They've been taught, taught to think that way.
Yeah.
Their doctrine teaches them to think that way.
Amen.
We are the one true, or whatever. Every group has this particular approach to the matter. But they assume that they're right. And have the same mind, the scripture says. Philippians 1:27 and 2:2. Have the same mind. Well, these Pharisees didn't have the same mind as John the Baptist at all. As an example, this kind of situation existed in that day too. It's an example. The Pharisees believed there would be a resurrection of the dead. They believed there were angels, and they believed there were spirits. Now the Sadducees, with whom they hobnobbed, they didn't believe that there were angels. They didn't believe that there were spirits. And they didn't believe there was a resurrection. And the being with the Pharisees didn't change their mind. They kept on believing that way. And all you had to do, bring up one of those subjects, and boy, you had the head button going on. And what did Paul do when he was standing for a group of them? He made them attack each other. He wasn't a peacemaker at that point. He said, now concerning the resurrection of the dead, that's what I brought into question about. Wow, that set a row off between the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And the Pharisees said, oh, wait a minute, we can't be too hasty here. Maybe an angel or some spirit has spoken to him. See, but the Sadducees didn't believe in that. So they had this situation. Right there, Jesus faced this situation of people in the same religious group that were at loggerheads with one another. There were some churches that Jesus addressed in Asia that had some among them that held to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which doctrine he said he hated. So there was a group of a particular church that had people in it that believed things that are contrary to each other. Well, don't you know this condition still exists? I mean, which one of you hasn't faced this? You face people in the same church who had fundamental disagreements on major pivotal truth. Even though God said, have the same mind, have the same judgment, be of one mind, said it plainly, in the Greek or in the English, very plain, but it's just like it wasn't there. See? So now they're thinking within this institutional mindset, if you're not Christ, and if you're not Elijah, and if you're not the prophet, and we can't think anybody else, then how come you're baptizing? Well, of course, we're living in a day when, the average churchman wouldn't even have enough sense to ask that question. The average churchman is not familiar enough with the scripture to have any idea what that was all about. They'd read that text and they'd just say, what in the world are they talking about? See? John did baptize in the wilderness and preach the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. That's Mark 1:4. That was a new thing. See? Nobody done that before. So they figure that could only be done by Christ or by Elijah or by the prophet. No one could start a new thing except them. So now, John, how come you're starting this new thing if you're not one of them? Pretty good question, I thought. Now, some people, almost all commentators say this, that the Jews practiced baptism when they made proselytes. And they take for granted, because they said that like we all believe it. Nothing in the Bible about that. Nothing in all God's word even gave a hint of a ceremony that happened when a man became a proselyte. The Jews did do this, but it was developed after the Babylonian captivity. It was a Jewish tradition. It was not something God instituted. And these commentators, may the Lord close their mouths, don't take time to tell people that. This was not a God-ordained ordinance for proselytes. That when a Gentile became a Jew, the Jews constructed, well after the Babylonian captivity, this process. And it's spelled out in some Jewish writing. I'll read this for you. First, he was circumcised. When the circumcision healed, he was stripped of all his clothes in the presence of three witnesses who had acted as his teachers and who now acted as his sponsors, the fathers of the proselyte, and led to a tank or pool. As he stood there up to his neck in water, they repeated the great commandments of the law. These he promised and vowed to keep, and then with an accompanying benediction, he plunged under the water. To leave one hand breadth of his body unsubmerged would have vitiated the whole rite, voided it. That's Jewish, that's Talmudic, Jewish traditional teaching. So they did practice that. But that's not what this is all about here. What they were referring to were the various washings that were instituted under the law. Because the word washings is baptismos, which is translated baptism. In the Bible, in baptism, immersion is not the main point. It's cleansing. That's the main point. Cleansing that was done while they were submerged in the water. See, but I come from a group that made him how you were dipped in the water, that was the main point. Well, that's not the main point in Scripture, baptism at all. It's wash away your sins. That's the main point. That happens when you are baptized. What then drove this question? These washings that were under the law, they had washings where they put things under the water and cleansed them. And people were cleansed also. The Scriptures refer to these washings in Hebrews 9:10, which is saying that the old covenant stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings. And some versions say diverse baptisms, because that is what it means. Under the law was a cleansing ceremony, but it was only a ceremony. There wasn't any real cleansing that took place. It was just a ceremony. All right, these men knew that the law had prophesied a kind of a washing that was coming, kind of a cleansing that was coming. For instance, Ezekiel or Jeremiah 33:8, he said, I will cleanse them from all iniquity. Cleansing was by washing under the law. I will cleanse you, Ezekiel 36:25, and Ezekiel 37:23. Ananias told Paul, arise and be baptized, washing away all your sins. This is what Paul declares takes place when you're baptized and sins are washed away. See, this is a new thing. So this is what these men knew. The only kind of washing we know about, baptism, they think of baptism as a washing. The only kind of washing is what this God promised he was going to do, going to cleanse them. And this had to be, they thought, this had to be either Elijah, Christ, Elijah, or the prophet. Who else would do this? See, who else had ever right to baptize anybody? That's how they were thinking. But this was what Scripture called baptism into Christ, is the washing of regeneration. Titus 3:5. Or the washing of rebirth, as the NIV says. So this is precisely how John's baptism was described now. It was the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. The questioners could not see how this could be accomplished by anybody other than Christ, Elijah, or the prophet. See? Now I'm going to say enough here that should make you suspicious that today there may be people that are still practicing John's baptism. But they think it's Christ's baptism. I'm going to prove this to you before we're done. So John answered. He's going to answer them directly. I baptize with water, not in water. See, if you're talking about the word immerse, then it's in water. But if you're talking about wash, it's with water. See, there's... It's a technicality, but when you've been taught one way to think, I mean, it's hard to break out of that mold of thinking that way. It's with water. I baptize with water. That's right. He was John the Baptist. Baptist means baptizer. That's what the word means. Some versions translate it that way. Matthew says, I indeed baptize you with water unto, or in order to, it can be because of repentance. Mark reads, I indeed have baptized you with water. Luke says, I indeed baptize you with water. Now I want to take a moment here. There are two things associated with John's baptism. First, it was unto repentance. Other versions say for repentance. Or because of repentance. The word translated unto repentance, is the Greek word eis, which whatever value it is to you. That's the same word used in Acts 2:38. Repent and be baptized, everyone in the name of Jesus Christ, for. It's the same word is used there. Except when Peter said it, he had added something to this. In the name of Jesus Christ. Repentance was mentioned. Forgiveness of sin was mentioned. That was both. John had that too. John's baptism was for the remission of sin. That's what it says. Mark 1:4. But then Peter added in the name of Jesus Christ. And he also added that you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. John's baptism didn't do that. You remember when Paul encountered some disciples at Ephesus? He didn't ask them, have you all been baptized yet? That's not what he asked them. That's what people ask today, but that's not what he asked. He said, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? They said, we didn't even know there was a Holy Spirit. They probably thought it was an evil spirit. That's all they knew about. And he said, well, What about your baptism? So we were baptized with John's baptism, which was a baptism unto repentance for the remission of sins. Paul said, well, there's some things about John's baptism you don't know. John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. So his baptism was leading up to Christ. Valid baptism is coming into Christ. It's a whole lot of difference. But isn't it interesting you asked that question? What if you asked that question to someone today? You just said right out to them, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? I'm trying sometime. Find someone that you're not sure exactly how they'd answer and ask them that question. It's a legitimate Bible question. Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? If they say, we didn't know you did such a thing, well, what kind of baptism were you baptized with? So John verily baptized with baptism of repentance, or repentance, unto repentance. The other thing is his baptism was for the remission of sins. In other words, read, for the forgiveness of sins, or unto the remission of sins, as a sign of forgiveness of sin. In all of the Gospels, Mark, that mention is Mark 1 and Luke 3, say it was his baptism was for the remission of sins. See? I wasn't taught that by the institution. The institution led me to believe that the only baptism for the remission of sins was baptism into Christ. Oh, yes, they did. And that's what they talked about. But John's baptism was for the remission of sins. That's as the Holy Spirit says. But baptism into Christ involves several things that were in John's baptism. And this is what distinguishes it. It's not how you're baptized, it distinguishes this baptism. For instance, we're baptized into Christ's death. All right, that John's baptism didn't do that. And in baptism, wherein we are risen with him. That happened. We experience the circumcision of Christ and are quickened or made alive. Yet John's baptism didn't have that. And we're baptized into Christ. Galatians 3:27, and we put on Christ, Galatians 3:27, and we're baptized into one body, 1 Corinthians 12:13, and we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit as a promise. See, baptism into Christ is unique, and it's what's unique about it that needs to be preached. See, should we mention remission of sin? Well, Peter mentioned it, of course, but see, you got to go. You got to give some more information about it. Things you got remission of sin in John's baptism. Your sins are remitted in John's baptism before Jesus died, which teaches you that John wasn't preaching under the law. He's preaching in an interim period of time. These Pharisees knew this, and nobody could do this in an interim period, they thought, unless it was Christ, Elijah, or the prophet. Yeah, I guess if we're talking to someone that doesn't know much about the Bible, you could make a pretty good case of that. So he says, I'm baptizing you with water, with it, not in it, with it. And then he's going to tell them later that Jesus is going to baptize with something too. There stands one among you whom ye know not, he said. Someone stands among you that you know not. Now it was not until the next day that John saw Jesus. John 1:29 says, the next day he saw Jesus and said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Now, well, the question arises, was that before Jesus was baptized or after he was baptized? And people argue about it. I'm going to take the position that it was before he was baptized. Because the scripture says in Mark 1:12 that when he was baptized, immediately the Spirit drove him in the wilderness. So he didn't come back. So what this is saying is Jesus probably was at several of these baptisms. This wasn't like the first time. But John didn't know who it was. But later he'll tell you that's why he was baptizing, because when the Messiah came, he would be baptized, and at his baptism, that's when it'd be revealed who it was. So John, as I understand it, figured that the Messiah was in the crowd someplace. He didn't know who it was. He said, "The one standing among you, whom you know not." We know they didn't know him. He didn't know him because the first 30 years of his life, nobody really knew who he was. In fact, the people identified from his hometown where he was raised up, the people said he was the carpenter's son. And it could name his four brothers, or really half-brothers, and some of his sisters. And even the expert doctors or experts in the law when he was 12 years old had no idea who this young man was. They marveled at his understanding, at his answers. They didn't know who it was. And Mary and Joseph didn't know who he was either. Because they said, "Didn't you know your father and I," Mary said, "didn't your father and I sought you sorrowing?" He said, "Did you know I had to be about my father's business?" Mary had to ponder on it. See, this got away from them too, who this really was. So it ought to be here noted that there are those who make Jesus relevant to the people. See, they try and bring Jesus down so the people can understand it. But if you do that, you have hidden Jesus. You've not made him known. You see this? You've not made him known. You've concealed him. Because the more like you see Jesus as, the less you see who he really is. He was made like, he had a body and he was a man. But that's about the extent. He was tempted. That's about the extent of it. But see, there are people who try and make Jesus more like a buddy or a friend or a close associate. They bring him down. But when you bring him down, the veil comes over the heart. You can't see him like he really is. Somebody's got to come along and knows and bring him up and declare who he really is. "He it is," he said, "the one that's coming after me. He it is who coming after me is preferred before me. He it is," he's the one, in other words, he's the one I'm preaching about, that's the Christ. He's the one. Now, Jesus said of John, "Verily I say unto you, among them born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist." So, and he said, "There's one coming after me that's preferred before." That was really some statement to make, because there was nobody born that was preferred before John the Baptist until Jesus came. Every other mortal born was under John the Baptist. Jesus did not risen a greater. No. Of those made of woman, there's not arisen a greater than John the Baptist. John the Baptist said, "He's coming after me, as he's going to begin his ministry after my ministry." His coming, he's not talking about his birth. He's talking about his ministry. He's going to come after me, but he's going to overshadow me. My ministry is going to become like obsolete when he comes. And he's going to yield to the preeminence of Christ, see. "Who coming after me," as I have said, means his ministry. And some verses read that way. His ministry follows mine. The Living Bible says, "And will soon begin his ministry among you." See, Jesus' ministry is when he really came. There was a sense in which he came when he was born. But that he came, he was located in earth, but he really came when his ministry started. That's when he, "Lo, I come to do thy will, O God." That didn't begin in the cradle. That began in his ministry. Everything up to that point was preparatory. When he come into the world, the first begotten, Hebrews 1:6, "When he," God, "bringeth in the first begotten into the world," he said, "let all the angels of God worship him." See? That's what he said. He didn't say let everybody hear him. That was later. Hear ye him. That was at his transfiguration, you remember, and at his baptism. So here's the ways Jesus came. That's when he first came into the world. Jesus himself said, I am come that they might have life. When he returned to the Father, before he returned, he said, I will come again. I will come unto you. That was he talking about the Holy Spirit there. And then he said to him, if I go, I will come again at his second coming. So there's his coming, birth, coming, began ministry, coming, send the Holy Spirit, coming, second coming. See, so it's, all of these were coming of Christ. But when John said, he cometh after me, he's talking about his ministry, when he started his ministry. And as with John, and so it is with us, Jesus has the preeminence in all things. You've got to yield to Christ. If you think you got your rights, you got to yield. If you got a message you're preaching that's different than Jesus, you got to yield to Christ. He's preferred before me. That's why it's folly to talk about what I want and what I like and all this sort of thing. It's what it is. Jesus, you got to yield to him. He's preferred. Preferred by who? Preferred by God. Amen. Whatever you may think God thinks of you, he thinks more of Christ. He thinks more of Christ than he thinks of you. Amen. There's going to be some people that he's going to damn. We, by God's grace, it's not going to be us, we pray. But if it comes to a clash between you and Christ, God will choose Christ.
That's right.
Every time.
That's right.
He's preferred by God before me. In other verses, he preferred, say, read, who has a higher rank than me. That's a good ranks higher. He surpassed me, NIV says. Ranks ahead of me, New Revised Standard. He's been put before me, Williams. He's not second place to anyone or to me. Amplified Bible says he's preferred before me. Now, it's interesting to note that most later versions omit this phrase. They omit this, preferred before me. They omit that phrase. Almost all modern versions omit it. But in my understanding, this is not wise, because it's mentioned, that very phrase, preferred before me, is mentioned in John 1:15 and verse 30, and all these other versions have it there. So this is preferred before me, mentioned three times. One of them, the translators chose to take it out. Well, they got their reasons, but they're just not good reasons. If the Holy Spirit put it in, upon what basis is someone going to take it out? Because the Coptic gospel doesn't have it, or the Ethiopian gospel doesn't have it, or the Syrian gospel doesn't have it? John makes the conclusion, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy to untie his shoes. Well, we say loose the shoelace. I'm not worthy to serve him. I'm not even worthy to be one of his slaves. That's how he saw Christ.
Amen.
He's superior to everything. I'm not worthy of the least. Jacob said, I'm not worthy of the least of all that benefits. So we could all join in. If you're honesty and insightful, you can say this, I'm not worthy of the least of all the benefits. You just think of all the benefits you've got tonight. You're not worthy of even the smallest one of them. So the very smallest benefit you got, if there is such a thing as a small benefit, of the least, you're not even worthy of the least, to say nothing of the great promises of God. See, now I tell you, God looks kindly upon a person who thinks like this. It's a humble and contrite spirit that thinks like this. If you admit this is the truth, this is the truth, we're not worthy. But if you admit it, God will make you worthy. Worthiness. Jesus spoke of those who shall be counted worthy to obtain that world and the resurrection from the dead. Well, everyone's going to be raised from the dead, but for some, they're going to obtain the resurrection. obtain the resurrection. It'd be to their advantage, in other words. But there are those to be counted worthy to obtain that world. And for the resurrection of the dead to be an advantage, so your spirit fits in that body. That obtainment will be by grace through faith, but it's very real worthiness. There's a unique worthiness that can be experienced. When Peter, the apostles, were beaten and let go, said they rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. Worthy to suffer shame for his name. Why would you call it worthy to suffer? Because there's rewards for suffering. Take the rewards for suffering out, and it changes the whole picture. But those that are counted worthy to suffer will be counted worthy of the reward. Good to see, isn't it? In fact, we're admonished, walk worthy of the Lord, unto all pleasing. Do it now, do it. And I admonish you to do this. Walk worthy of the Lord. You say, well, I don't know if I can or not. Do it anyway. Walk worthy of the Lord. You say, how am I going to do it? Well, ask for grace to help in the time of need. Have you thought about that? Ask for that. Grace to help in the time of need. And walk worthy of God. I mean, you may meet with a applause of your friends and the accolades of the institution, but how about pleasing with God? How about getting some praise from God? Walk worthy of God. Paul wrote to the Thessalonians concerning their persecutions. He said that they are a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God, that he may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God. These are the straight and narrow way. The walls are very tight. It's kind of painful getting through these narrow gate, narrow way. What that is, that's sufferings for Christ's sake. In other words, these sufferings slough off some stuff that can't, remember, right? Sloughs off some stuff that can't get in. That you could be counted worthy.
And those who don't suffer, they won't be able to get in.
That's right.
They'll have too much.
Amen. Too much baggage.
Yep.
Yeah. Now this all happened where John was baptizing. Now I gather it was near Salem, but I gather prior to this, it was near Salem. I gather that he was baptizing there for the same reason he was baptized in Ainon near to Salem, because there was much water there, John 3:23. So wherever John is baptizing, they didn't have a vial of water. I dedicate this to all who sprinkle and pour for baptism. Like, what exactly do you do with this? Huh? You can't even wash with a sprinkle or a pour. You can't wash with that. So he's baptized where there was much water. When the Ethiopian eunuch saw water, it wasn't a bottle of water, it was a pool of water that he saw. So that's John's answer, pretty wise answer, wasn't it? And you can see that, this is just my persuasion. I would love to find out that I'm wrong on this. I think a lot of people I know have actually been baptized with John's baptism. Jesus hasn't been very prevalent in it. And they just did it for remission of sins, and sometimes they're taught that pretty much is it. But that's John's baptism. We're not advocating rebaptizing a bunch of people, and I'm not hinting at that at all, but I'm saying I don't question that there are some people probably should be. Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? Person says, I don't know. I didn't know that you did. So I said, well, what about your baptism? What kind of baptism? Well, I was sprinkled as a baby. Well, there you have it. That's it. That's what we got. That you did. You weren't baptized then. See? Well, I was poured. when I was christened. Well, and that's what the problem is. Well, I just went forward, you know, I just was baptized because everybody else was. Well, that's what the Pharisees tried to do. Okay, so at any rate, it's something to ponder. I don't want to introduce a lot of questions, but I can see how Satan would work with that. Let me put it that way. Any of you have a word you'd like to add tonight? Yeah.
I never really thought about what John said about Jesus, whom ye know not. Yeah. John said a lot about Jesus. And even after everything he said, the Jews were confused and unsure about who Jesus was until today, actually. But I thought that is a profound witness about the condition of humanity, is that a man from God can come and say, this is who he is, and they still know him not.
Amen.
And so that confirms that no man knows who the Son is except the Father, and to whom the Father will reveal him.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus even testified of himself. The angels testified. There's multiple sources of testimony as to who Jesus is, but they still decided that he was worthy of death.
And something else that we can see here in that verse, these things were done in Pythagora beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. That assumes that the people he was baptizing were standing by and heard discourse.
That's right.
So the progressing work of the Lord, he has preferred before me, it's going to get out. People are going to know about it. We addressed that, I guess it was last week, when the things were spread abroad through the hill country.
Yeah.
So again, what God is doing will get out, but we also see the humility of John, not to pull him aside and say, he's preferred before me, but tell everyone my baptism isn't what you're supposed to stay with, because obviously there's someone among you whom you know not who is greater and preferred before me. So God's work will never go without being noticed.
Amen. Anyone else?
I can see how now that John the Baptist was separated from this influence,
right.
And in the wilderness, and he came in, and I, it's remarkable. You know, we've gone over this lesson last week, and then here, how remarkable is he's so directed in his thinking. He's not led off. I mean, the way he answers is just right on. He's not pulled off into any kind of sidetrack or anything. He's dead on Christ. And you know, I hadn't thought about that, but you know, you're probably right about that. He has not seen Christ. He's seen him, but he didn't know Christ yet. He would not be made known to him until the Spirit descended on him. So he was in the crowd, you can bet, but nobody knew who he was. So John the Baptist could say, though, that he's standing among us.
That's right.
It's remarkable how he was so, the word escapes me, but he was just, he was focused on this. He wasn't led astray. It's remarkable.
Yeah, it tells you something about Jesus, too. I think Jesus was found, like if he was found in the temple when he was 12, it makes sense he was found at John's baptism when John was preparing the way. But he wasn't made. He didn't know until he was made known. And he says later, "I knew him not." He knew Jesus as a relative, as a godly relative, because he said, "I have need to be baptized of you." See, that wasn't because he saw him as the Messiah, because it was after he was baptized that the dove descended, not before. That's when he really knew who this was. That's the whole reason he was baptized. Go ahead.
Your comments and insight about John's baptism and Jesus' baptism. The statement about John being baptized for the remission of sin has always troubled me. I've not seen it clearly like you've made it this evening. I appreciate that very much. And for those who have a background like I, with the wrong emphasis in teaching about baptism, it was wrong.
Yeah.
Amen.
And your statement about John not teaching under the jurisdiction of the law, but during the interim period.
Yeah.
Well, I know a lot of folks that say, oh, yeah, give me a scripture on that.
Yeah.
Well, there is one.
There is one.
There is one. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached.
That's
every
right.
man presseth into it. The
That's
Lord's
right.
own words there in Luke 16:16. So there is a statement about that.
Actually, it
took me a couple of minutes to remember it, but
yeah,
it's there.
You're exactly right. And I can see the sense of it. To prepare for Christ,
yes.
there had to be a break from the old the old way. And this is how I did. John the Baptist is it bridged that gap.
And for those willing to investigate and pay attention, there are numerous distinctions between John's baptism and Jesus' baptism. And the emphasis of Christ's baptism, of course, is new life.
That's right.
New life, newness. That's the emphasis. Not the method, not the mode, but the life.
That's
that
right.
comes through it.
And
through
it, one text that is almost universally ignored is, by one spirit are you baptized into one body.
Yeah.
So that took place.
Yes, yes.
Because the spirit, see, he position, God uses him to position the person in the body of Christ. So that's another.
Most of what I've been taught from that text right there is don't mention it. That's a dangerous text.
I know. They might think
for,
you're
for those who emphasize baptism.
Yeah. Because someone might think you're
Yes. Oh boy, they sure will. You talk about it too much and you'll be branded.
You see what liberty you have in Christ?
Amen.
Now this is liberty. It's not just liberty to believe anything. It's liberty to believe the truth, and there's something about it that liberates the soul. Frees you up.
Modern example of the importance of being baptized into Christ was Sister Katie.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Because she was sprinkled, and I suppose a person could justify and say, well, she's already been baptized.
Yeah.
Obviously, people in the Catholic Church say she already has been baptized.
Yeah.
But she wasn't baptized.
That's right.
And so we see the product of that, which shows the validity of what she did there, because now she's just taken off
yeah.
in the faith, and she's growing in the new life we can see. And so
Amen.
I appreciate what you said tonight.
Amen.
See, Catholicism and Presbyterianism teach that the new covenant is appended to the old covenant. That's why they get the infants or the children of Christians or baptized Christians. That's where they get that. They believe the new covenant is appended to the old. Brother Justin.
I thought that John's baptism was like a trial for Christ, and it wasn't really a baptism. It was just like something that, kind of like a form that we're getting ready for. That's how I was taught. But this is this thing that this was an actual baptism with water for the remission of sins.
For the remission of sins, that's right. See, now, you couldn't have remission of sin under the law. The law had to have been abrogated as a means to righteousness, because the law didn't provide for remission of sin. Who was it? Sister, yes.
And also, too, like, you might question your own baptism if you've been in a group. All of us has been in different groups, and they taught things that weren't so. I questioned my own, but then I asked myself, had I received the Spirit? And I knew I had, so I knew that it was
right.
valid, you know. So if you can tell if you've received the Spirit of the Lord
mm-hmm.
because you're understanding, we know. But people may question that, but you don't have to question your baptism just because you may have been a Baptist or a Methodist
yep.
or Jehovah's Witness
it's
or
what
whatever.
Your heart
you.
Was. See, it's what your,
Amen.
Yeah. what your heart was. Look, the heart man believes in the
Amen.
Heart.
Amen.
So
yeah.
It's what your heart was, and that's something you can't diagnose someone else's heart.
Be baptized in and not be.
That's right.
Don't matter what group you're in.
That's the determination they have to make. That's,
yeah. Amen.
That's nothing
that
we
Amen.
Can
say. I too was sprinkled when I was an infant. I didn't know it until I was 11 or 12 years old, something like that. I'd already been immersed into Christ. Well, my mother told me then that she was wrong about doing that.
Hmm.
And she was glad now that had been corrected, because she misunderstood and had been taught wrong.
Yeah, I've encountered several people like that, and I admire them. I admire people like that who were humble and saw the error and went about to correct it. Yes. Anyone else tonight? Just about.
You see the mercy of the Lord here too. This shift of coming out of the era of the law.
Yeah.
I was thinking about that. Whenever there's a big shift like that, of something that's been established for so long, sometimes there's a deterioration and a crumbling of what used to be fundamental. But the Lord very quickly here with John, you mentioned how short his ministry was. He's very quickly laying a foundation for his
people. Amen. Amen.
So this thing is going to begin with surety in a very short time so that then it can continue to be built upon.
Isn't that something? Jesus just took over. Just made the transition, didn't have to make any major adjustment. Well, that's good. See, this is true of you and I. If we do a valid work in preparing people, then Jesus can just take it and just move right on with it. Bring it to perfection. Yeah. All right, let's have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful for John the Baptist. We thank you that you sent him. We thank you for his powerful witness and for his humility. We cannot think, Father, of a better way to introduce your Savior than a prophet like John the Baptist. We thank you for him in Jesus' name. Amen.